Hello, church. Thank you for joining me today. You know, we're in the series, The Next Steps. And when I'm thinking about the next steps, I'm thinking about IKEA. They're famous for their simple instructions. The projects start out looking like this. Very simple. You could understand. They don't use words. But then the very next page, boom, they give you the whole meal deal there. You know, I learned a very important lesson. In fact, it's one we've all learned at some point in our lives. And it's this: information does not equal transformation. I knew the information to put it together, but that didn't make me a handyman. It didn't make me competent to do it. I think we've all experienced this throughout our lives. For you, it might not be IKEA furniture. Maybe it was a DIY project gone wrong around the house. Just because you watched a YouTube video and got the information doesn't make you a plumber, and I could attest to that. Now, you could read all the books on marriage you like, but that doesn't mean you'll have a great marriage. You could go to school and get a business degree and not have a great business. You could go to church and not be a transformed follower of Jesus Christ. You know, this is why a person can go to church their whole life and be an angry, judgmental Christian. You need more than information to lead to spiritual transformation. This is what this whole series is all about. We want to help people take their next step in their relationship with Jesus so they could be transformed. It's not just things that we do to check off. You're a follower of Jesus, and He is supernaturally empowering you to become more like Him. Now, this is so incredibly important for the world we live in right now, your neighborhood, your sphere of influence. People, especially post high school, are walking away from their faith. And maybe that's you. You've heard all the information. You know the stories, all the Bible stories, right? But for whatever reason, it didn't seem to work for you. Now, this is so crucial, because there is a false assumption that once people understand the gospel, they prayed the prayer, I prayed the sinner's prayer, or they read their Bible, then they will follow Jesus. And they won't have doubts, questions in their lives, and their lives will be transformed. Now, the problem is information doesn't lead to transformation. So if information doesn't lead to transformation, what does? Information plus experience equals transformation. Now, what information and what experience do I need, do you need to be transformed? You need the right information and the right experience. Otherwise, transformation is skewed. It's not going to be right. Right information plus bad experience equals a negative transformation. Bad information plus a good experience equals confusion. Wrong information plus wrong experience equals wrong transformation. The answer is found in two passages in the Bible. There's probably more, but these are the two that I focused on. We're going to look at a very short parable that Jesus taught, and then look at another situation with him and his disciples. So here Jesus is talking with his disciples in Luke chapter 17, 7 through 10. Suppose one of you has a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Will he say to the servant when he comes in from the field, "Come along now and sit down to eat"? Well, the answer would be no, and so here's a quick history lesson. In Jesus' day and age, it was customary for the slaves to finish their work before dinner, prepare their master's meal, and then serve themselves. Back to the scripture. Won't he rather say, "Prepare my supper, get yourself ready, and wait on me while I eat and drink. After that, you may eat and drink"? Yeah, that's exactly what he would say, the master to his servant. Will he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? No, he won't thank the servant because the servant did his job. So you also, when you, disciples, followers of mine, have done everything you were told to do, should say, "We are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty." The point is simple. A servant is unworthy of praise or special treatment because he has only done what he is supposed to do. A servant's job is to serve. It's literally what servants do. It's in the name, it's in the title. The point of the story is that Jesus' disciples are servants of God. You and me, servants of God. And servants serve. Imagine you started a new job and you woke up and you got dressed and you showed up at 9 a.m., your starting time, logged into your computer, made some phone calls, and you made your first sale of the week, one sale. You then immediately go to your boss's office and ask him for a raise. What do you think the boss is going to say? You want a raise for doing what you agreed to do? So here's two quick points about being servants of God. Serving isn't an extra credit assignment. If you have the time or if you feel guilty enough in church as you're listening to this, it's, oh, I got to serve. Now, as a youth pastor a while back, I've had the question, what's the bare minimum it takes to follow Jesus? And they would follow up, just believe, or do I have to be obedient too? My answer back then is the same today. It'll cost you everything. And that's the minimum requirement, everything. And I didn't come up with that answer. Jesus did. It's in the Bible. Serving isn't adding to your to-do list. Serving is all about rearranging your priorities. If we are servants, who do we serve? Well, first off, we serve God by loving people. Don't wait for others to serve you first. If you wait for them to go first, you're just reciprocating. You're not serving, you're just kind of hand in hand. Servants don't wait for their masters to serve them before they start serving. The servants serve and do it joyfully and humbly. Now more than often, people usually don't mind serving as long as they aren't treated like a servant. There's something so beautiful about being served by someone. Now keep in mind, I'm not saying to let someone, or anyone really, take advantage of you or treat you poorly. However, I am saying that the humbleness that is required to lovingly serve someone is a good thing. And we could all use some more of it. The true test of our servanthoodness, now I know that's not a word, is how well we serve someone again after getting a poor or no response from our service. Now that could be tough. For most of us, being a servant is something we have to work up to. It's not our natural state of mind. After we serve, we want a positive response, at least a thank you. I think we have the same attitude serving God. I read my Bible today, I prayed, and I wrote down something in a journal or took a note of it. Now today is going to be a great day, right, God? Or even I tithed and I gave money to the church. Or I was full of anxiety, but I hosted a small group. And then I even went to church today. And we would say to God, well, that's got to count for something. It's very dangerous for us to presume that because we've done something God-honoring, that He now has to honor us. We are servants of God. We serve Him and people. In fact, we serve Him as we serve people. It's what servants do. Let's look at our second story. Jesus has predicted His death, just did, in Mark chapter 10. And this takes verse 35 through 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Oh, wow. Now that's a bold request. Have you ever done that to God? God, give me what I request. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. They replied, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? Can you lay down your life for others? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. Now when the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be a slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Being a servant is the greatest job in the world. This is what Jesus did for us. We are following in his footsteps. This is what he wants us to do all the time. So then what does this mean? What do we do with this? So back to our little equation here. Information plus experience equals transformation. You are a servant, so you serve others. Serving no longer feels like serving. It's just something you do without even thinking about it. And here's what's so great about this. When you and I live out our title of servant, when we serve others, our relationships get better, and then our ego dies, and other people really like that as we're serving humbly. The gospel of Jesus Christ moves from information to transformation because you have experienced it. You have served and shared God's love with others, and you have been served and received God's love. You make the gospel real for the next generation. And this is so important, the next generation, because the stats show that young people are walking away from church and their faith. Now, if our kids walk away from their faith, it won't be because of lack of information. It will be a lack of experience, that positive experience with Jesus, living it out. They have all the information at their fingertips. What's missing are experiences that match up to the information they have received. Well, experiences like trusting God when things don't make sense, or that God really does love them unconditionally. Also knowing they are welcome at church in a group by the older generation. That next generation, the younger generation, need to know this. They need safe adults they can talk to and ask difficult questions to. That they need people who will help them wrestle with their identity and who they are in God, in Christ. That they need men and women who will respect them, be available to them, teach them, love them, support them, help them understand how Jesus fits into every area of their life. Throughout the day, this is how Jesus fits in there. Now, if you grew up in the church, and I did, look back over your life. I bet most of us, the times we grew in our faith the most involved adults or older people or more mature Christians pouring into our lives. By serving, we give people an experience that matches their information and leads to transformation. Now, will you take the next step and serve on a team? If you do this, we are being transformed and becoming more and more like Jesus, loving God by serving people. Our marriages and our families will experience greater love. The gospel is felt and not just known. The next generation and generations to come are transformed into the hands and feet of Jesus, sharing not just information, but experiences of God's love with others, who place their faith in Jesus and are then transformed as well. We live the greatest life we could possibly live when we serve others.